Our next speaker is Mr. Ratan Jalan, founder and principal consultant at Medium Healthcare Consulting. He is an innovator, thought leader, inspirational speaker, teacher with over 40 years of experience across industries ranging from IT, advertising to healthcare. Let's welcome the gully boy of healthcare, Mr. Ratan Jalan.
Can you hear me? Before I react to, am I too loud? It's okay. So before I react to that introduction, Pramod, can you play a film? It's a 30-second film, and it's very poor quality. You may not be able to hear it.
India is a country with. India is a country with 1.3 billion population. Obese.
It's called.
Hola, professor. Comment allez-vous?
So a large number of times what the patient thinks the doctor is thinking is not what the doctor is thinking. I don't know whether you have heard of this one. The doctor is examining the patient's chest examination, and the doctor says, in no time the chest swelling will disappear. And the patient smiles, and the doctor says, why are you smiling? The patient says that, I know, I'm sure it will happen. And the doctor says, in that case, why are you smiling? And the patient says, that's not swelling, that's my wallet. But anyway, this girl said everything, and then she said, gully boy of healthcare. And somewhere Vishy always thinks that I take panga, you know. So, I mean, that's a very appropriate title for me. But I also realize that the ace is not on my side, nor is Deepika Padukone. So I'll try to do the best I can. And before I begin, there are only two things. That whatever I'm going to say, sometimes I may sound harsh in my observations. So I think you'll have to take it in the right perspective. My attempt also is not to generalize what I'm saying. So I think you must understand that. Can we have the presentation? So that's the title of the presentation, How Not to Be a Doctor. And the only request I have from each one of you is while I'm talking, it is not me who is talking. So what I have done actually is that in the last 1 year, and that's me without the makeup, so in the last 1 year, I've read quite a few books, and these are some of the books. And what I'm going to talk to you about is the learning I've had from some of these books. So very frankly, these are not my thoughts. These are what I've learned from some of these books. So to that extent, if there is an issue of source credibility, I'm not the source. So I just want to make that clear. Then let me begin. So this is the first one, the title of the talk, which is How Not to Be a Doctor. And the gentleman, John Lorner, he's a practicing general physician, very senior, and he also writes very often. He writes very often in British Medical Journal and a whole lot of magazine and, you know, very respected publications. And what John Lorner says, just listen to him, that of all professions, doctors are almost invariably the most proficient at not listening. I don't know how many of us are surprised. And he actually goes to say, There is a wonderful distinction between listening in order to speak and speaking in order to listen. And some of us may know of that. And he makes it very clear that when you speak to listen and when you listen to speak, they are two completely, completely different things. And he actually talks about, in his book, a middle-aged, you know, a patient, a lady who is about maybe 65 year old, and she comes to visit a physician, and she's been suffering from a condition or maybe a set of conditions that nobody has been able to diagnose for almost 10 or 12 years. So she comes to this physician and she has a stack of reports and results and everything else, and she says, "Doc, I have irritable bowel syndrome and I have not been able to gain weight. I'm losing weight, so could you please tell me what to do?" And this gentleman actually says, "Let's leave aside all the reports, all the results, everything else you have had in the last 10 or 12 years, and let's start from the beginning." And this doctor actually is Dr. John Lorner quotes him as one of the ideal examples. This doctor tells the lady or talks to the lady or listens to the lady as if he has all the time under the sun. So the only thing he does is he keeps on telling the lady, "And then what happened? And tell me more," etc., etc. And finally, he's the guy who actually does the right diagnosis, and the lady is relieved and she puts on weight and everything comes back to normal. So he actually talks about that as an example, then what listening does to the whole art of medicine. And in fact, I don't know who said, probably Dr. Osler or somebody said, that if only you allow the patient to talk, she will give you her diagnosis. So it's just that the reality is very different. And this is, trust me, Newsweek is a pretty reliable magazine. And they say, doctors interrupt patients, stop listening after 11 seconds on an average. And this data is for the specialist. So you can imagine a general physician. I remember going to a government hospital, and if I were to tell you what happens there, that you have a doctor and there's a queue of patients. Patients are not, so this lady, the poor lady, walks into the doctor's room. She's not even allowed to sit. She just stands. The doctor looks up. The look is supposed to mean, "What's wrong with you?" So this lady says, "Lose motion." She says in Telugu, I don't understand Telugu, but somebody translates for that maybe. And before she finishes "lose motion," the doctor has written his prescription and somebody said, "Next." The only thing I didn't understand, I'm not a doctor, the doctor didn't even ask who has the loose motion. So I'm just saying it can get as pathetic as that. So I'm going to talk about 10 books. This is the second one. Kill as few patients as possible. Again, a very, very Dr. Oscar London, a very famous doctor. That's actually the name of his book. And it also has a chapter called, you know, Kill as Few Patients as Possible. In fact, he has a very nice chapter which is titled, "Don't Feel Breast Lump Over the Phone." So he actually talks about that. But I'm going to talk about Rule 28 in his book. And the guy says, "Praise nurses and your patients will live forever or die happy." And I'll just quote, "I cannot understand physicians who adopt a hostile relationship with nurses. Early in my career, I discovered that a good nurse, like a loaf of bread, is the staff of life." He talks about, you know, nurses have taught me the intensive care that only compassion provides. And we all know how nurses get treated in this country. In fact, you talk to any hospital, you talk to the promoter, you talk to the physicians, and they will always say that the nursing schools are pathetic. When nurses join, they don't know anything. So you ask them a very innocent question, in which case, why didn't you train them? And they will say that they will leave anyway. So what happens is, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. You get nurses, you don't know anything. You don't train them because they leave. They leave because you don't train them. You don't pay them. So it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, and it goes on forever. So personally, I'm a big, and I believe nursing is the backbone of healthcare, but it's just that, you know, we don't even think she's back or bone or whatever. So it's a very sad state of affair. I love this poster on the left, nurses dispense comfort, compassion and caring without even a prescription. And the one you see on the right actually is something from Fernandez Hospital. So you have a hospital in the city itself, Fernandez Hospital, and if you speak to Dr. Avita Fernandez, he would say that there is no Fernandez Hospital without nursing. We are what we are because the nurses we have. And she has actually taken it one step ahead. She's organized a full-fledged 3-year training program to teach nurses the whole thing about midwifery. And look at this poster. In fact, she's very proud of this poster. She says that meet the world's most effective pain reliever. It is actually a midwife or a nurse for that matter. So that's nursing for you. The next is, quickly, again, Dr. Jerome Groopman is from Harvard Medical School. And he's written a book called How Doctors Think. And if you read the book, interestingly, Dr. Groopman talks about that when I speak to physicians or when I speak to doctors, they actually say, we don't even have time to think, how do we think? It's a very interesting take. And he talks about that he's not talking about listening. He actually is talking about how do we make decisions? How do we think? How do we make decisions? And he actually talked about radiology as one example. You probably have Dr. Avinash. So when you're talking about a radiologist's life, he's not listening to anyone for that matter. But he actually talks about that research has shown that how the same radiologist were to see the same report after a period of maybe 6 months, in about 20% of the cases, he will come to a different interpretation. And if you talk about at the same point of time, if you actually shown 100 reports to 100 radiologists, in at least 20% of the cases, about 20% of the cases, they'll come to a different interpretation. So Dr. Groopman actually talks about, let's say, the cognitive trap of thinking. So he gives a certain example that when a patient starts speaking, you just latch on to a word, whatever the word is. The patient says, I have headache, you know, pain, something. And everything then boils down to that anchor, that keyword. So he actually talks about the problem of anchoring. He talks about confirmation bias, that if you actually have got a diagnosis in your mind, then everything you look around for is something which is subjected to confirmation. That whatever confirmed that bias is what you go to say right. He talks about diagnosis momentum. Let's say if you're in emergency and if 12 patients have come because of some food poisoning, then 13th also is likely to be food poisoning. So he actually calls about diagnosis momentum, etc., etc. So he says that if you're not really aware of the pitfalls of the way we think, okay, we are going to land up in problem. So he's got a nice approach. He says, as patients, if we know what the way the doctors think, he said, what could the patients do? It requires a lot of courage. But he says that the patient can say, what else can it be? Could 2 things be going on to explain my problem? And thirdly, is there something in my test that seemed to be at odds with the diagnosis? I'll quickly run through. 20% of patients with serious conditions are first misdiagnosed. Again, this is Washington Post. It's not some normal publication. I have to run through. 4th book is What Doctors Feel. Thinking is different than feeling. Assuming the doctors feel. In fact, when a hospital says, we have touched millions, we want to touch millions more, we think it is life they are talking about, they actually are talking about dollars. So, in fact, when you're talking about feeling, in fact, you know, ironically in medical education, I believe doctors are taught, or, you know, I mean very routinely, that you're not supposed to get emotionally attached with patients, because they're going to be, that will cloud your judgment. To that extent, you're supposed to be a creature who is not emotional, etc., etc. But we all know what feeling is all about. Again, Dr. Osler, who says, you know, treat the patient, not the disease. Coming to feeling, there's this book called If Disney Ran Your Hospital. The gentleman on the right, his name is Fred Lee, and I flew to Florida to spend a day with him. Fred is no more. And interestingly, Fred says the book is dedicated to him. He speaks about four nurses in his life who actually shaped him. Fred himself is not a physician. He worked with a large hospital for about 20 years. He worked with Walt Disney also. So his mother was a nurse. He had two wives. Both of them were nurses. His daughter is a nurse. So we can imagine where Fred got the right feeling about healthcare. To quickly run through, Fred in his book talks about that if Disney ran your hospital, then you would ensure that courtesy is more important than efficiency. You will ensure that when you measure patient satisfaction, you do it to improve, not to impress. Okay, and in fact, in this country, every hospital will have such great NPS scores that it's amazing. We actually spent 3 days in a large hospital in Bangalore, and the NPS was pathetic. I mean, the patient satisfaction was pathetic. And the gentleman says our NPS is 82%. And the promoter of the hospital, and I remember telling him that you're saying NPS is 82%, Apple is 79%, Apple. And he says, I know Apple is going through difficult times. So create a climate of dissatisfaction. What can you do more? He talks about decentralize the authority to say yes. Trust me, if you stand at the reception of a hospital, if your bill is 13, 20 rupees, if you don't have 20 rupee change, the girl will tell you go outside and get change in case you don't have a credit card. Close the gap between knowing and doing. This lady, Regina Haslinger, she's a professor at Harvard. She talks about who killed healthcare. Essentially, she says that it is about transparency and it is about power. She says that there is no transparency in healthcare. When I'm talking transparency, I'm talking about quality. Or she's talking about quality and she's talking about price. And it'll take you a minute. You guys have that mango bite on your table, all of you. It costs 25 paisa. If you open the wrapper, it will tell you it contains 2.8 gram of sweet. What all it has, how much does it cost? But if you talk about 2.8 lakh CABG, you know nothing about it. So she actually talks about transparency and she says that the real issue is people don't want you to know because that would mean that you have the power. Carrying forward, you have this book called Unaccountable, and the guy says that why can't we get information about hospital quality or hospital price? And he says they make Herculean effort to ensure that you don't get. In this country, honestly, I'm yet to see an India class hospital. You know, you go to a hospital in Banjara Hill, you go to a hospital in Bhagalpur. It's like if you're a hospital, then you have to be world class. World class hospital is one word, there are two words. Every hospital is world class. And there is no second best in the country. There's no second best. So frankly, next time when you come across a physician or a hospital and the guy says, I am the best orthopedic hospital, just ask him who is the second best. He will say, we are opening a second branch in Nagpur. So now, when you talk quality, actually when you talk quality, how do you communicate quality? NABH is not the answer. Do we remember AMRI fire in Calcutta where we lost 100 patients? Any idea? AMRI was NABH accredited. What does NABH mean? In fact, there was this film of Anil Kapoor called Ubo Saat Din. NABH is all about those 7 days, that's it. So there is a life before NABH and there's life after NABH, and those two are very dramatic reality. Quality is also not about the trophy on your shelf or the award you get. I'm just saying we have folks opposite side of the road and you can buy whatever you want. It's a question of how much price you're willing to pay. So that's not quality. What is quality? I'll give you a quick example. You have this hospital called Hospital for Special Surgery in New York. And by the US News and Report, they've been rated to be the best orthopedic hospital for the last 24 years. 24 years without a break. Not Mayo, not Hopkins, no Cleveland. And what do they do? If you go to their website, it's on the website. They say, how do we measure quality? Surgical volume, infection, blood clot, fall, everything. And they quote everything. You will find statistics about everything in the hospital. So they're completely transparent about what clinical quality outcome is. To me, somebody has to have the courage to talk this language. It's not about best, you know, I'm just saying you will find a huge hoarding in Banjara Hill. Healthcare will never be the same again. That's not quality. Eighth is this book by Dr. Eric Topol, who talks about the patient will see you now, not the doctor will see you now. And the gentleman says that the future of healthcare is in your hands. And this is what I mean, that this is what he means. And we all know, in a poor country like India, there are more telephones than toilets or toothbrush, you know, whichever one you prefer. The more telephones, and he actually talks about that, like, telephone is the most democratized thing in this country. Who doesn't have it? I mean, at least voting, you need to be an adult. Phone, you don't need to be an adult. A three-year-old kid also has a phone. So he actually talks about how a smartphone or a phone is going to democratize healthcare. And what he says is that it would mean the end of paternalism, peer and peer medicine. Innovation will come from all sorts of new places. This is what we'll do. Ninth one is, slightly optimistic note, a book on Arvind Eye and the Dr. V says 5 minute $15 cure. And again, Arvind Eye talks about doctor's productivity. That's the way to bring down the cost, doctor's productivity. So in his Arvind Eye, a doctor's productivity, if you see India, is five times an average Indian surgeon. Five times. What I've written in the poor man's bedsheet, I mean, it's a cue to myself. If you go to Arvind Eye, okay, I mean, I visited them once, and they say that in our hospital, when the bedsheet actually is not usable, you know, kharab ho jati hai, we actually use that tablecloth at the camp. When it's not usable as tablecloth, we start using it as washing cloth or cleaning cloth. So it takes a lot to think like a poor person and bring down the cost. And the 10th one is not there because you have the Republic Day offer, so 10% discount. And Vishi insisted that at the end of the session, I have to have some takeaways. So frankly, the takeaways are very simple. There is no healthcare without empathy. There's no healthcare without transparency. Technology is going to play a big role. Cost is what we need to manage. And somebody said, gully boy. Any question? Between me and the lunch. Yeah. It is, so there's no right answer. So the guy says, you must develop the art of dissatisfaction. So if you ask me, okay, if it should be 100%. 100%. I mean, why shouldn't it be that everybody who walks out of a hospital is not a promoter? So in fact, if you go to Disney, they are only major promoters.
So, no question, but just a comment. It was very insightful and a beautiful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So thank you so much, and I was really anxious and I was worried because, I mean, if it is not what it is, then...
Thank you, Mr. Jalan.
Before lunch is going to be here.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really wonderful. I would request Mrs. Usha Anand to give away the memento. Thank you. Okay, let's go. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. We will move for lunch now, but I would request if you could go back to the room so that the further session can be made. You can also visit the stalls and the stalls.